Welcome you all. We are discussing in this lecture about different temperature sensors, transducers and signal conditioning circuit which are used for controlling the temperature parameters, and those are used in number of industrial applications. So, in the last lecture, we discussed about all types of converters. So, now in these lectures, we are going to discuss different temperature sensors and the signal conditioning circuit. Now, next one, temperature sensors. So, temperature is the most often measured environmental quantity. So, it is very easy to sense the temperature, but there are the number of devices or sensors available which is used for sensing the temperature. The temperature sensing can be done either through direct contact with the heating source or by remote, or without direct contact also we can sense the temperature. Now next one, so we will see the different types of sensors. So first type will be the RTD, that is the resistor temperature detector. So RTD is a temperature sensing device whose resistance changes with the temperature. So typically it is built from platinum, which is designed by using the devices nickel or copper, etc. It can be take many different shapes like wire wound, thin film. So it is used to measure the resistance. If we want to measure the resistance across RTD, because as temperature will change, the RTD will change its resistance. So how to measure that resistance? So apply a constant current which is passing through that RTD, then measure the voltage across that RTD. And based on the Ohm's law, you can easily determine what should be the new resistance value of that RTD. So RTD exhibits a fairly linear resistance to temperature curve over their operating regions. So example of this RTD, we can take PT100, which is used mostly in number of applications, number of circuits. So PT100 RTD has resistance of about 100 ohm at 0 degree Celsius. Means at 0 degree Celsius, the resistance of that RTD of PT100 will be 100 ohm. And at 100 degree Celsius, its resistance should be 138.5 ohm. So how to calculate the resistance of PT100 at any temperature T degree Celsius? It is given by that equation, that R, that is the resistance of PT100, is equal to 0.385 into T plus 100. So if you are putting temperature T as a 0 degree Celsius, then resistance will be 100 ohm. If you are putting temperature T is equal to 100 degree Celsius, then 100 into 0.385, that will give the 38.5 plus 100, that gives the 138.5 ohm. So at any temperature T degree Celsius, we can calculate the resistance of PT100. Now next type will be the thermistor. So thermistor, it is a similar to the RTD. The thermistor is a temperature sensing device whose resistance changes with temperature. Obviously there are the two types of thermistor actually, PTC and NTC. Positive temperature coefficient, that is PTC, and negative temperature coefficient, that is NTC. Now here NTC thermistors are shown here in this figure. So NTC means negative temperature coefficients, means as temperature increases, resistance decreases. That is called as NTC. So similarly, PTC means as temperature increases, resistance also increases. So in most of cases, we are going to use the NTC here. So NTC is used in the circuit most of the times to sense the temperature. So as temperature increasing, its resistance will going to decrease. Now thermistors are made from semiconducting materials. Resistance is determined in the same manner as the RTD. by connecting in the circuit, but thermistor exhibits a highly non-linear resistance versus temperature curve. So the graph of temperature versus resistance will not be a linear, it should be a curve one. So finally, in the thermistor operating range, we can see a large resistance change for very small temperature change. This makes for a highly sensitive device. So it is ideally suited for set point applications. Now next one will be the thermocouple. It is mostly accurate giving, and it is a mostly used temperature sensors, we can say. It is a type of temperature sensor which is made by joining two dissimilar metals at one end. The joint end will be called as or referred as hot junction. So how it will get construct? So take any two dissimilar metals, connect at one end, so that end is called as hot junction, and connect at other end, that other end is referred as cold junction. Now cold junction is actually formed at the last point of thermocouple material. If there is a difference in temperature between hot junction and cold junction, then a small voltage is created. That voltage we can say V1 minus V2. So this voltage is referred to as electromotive force, that is EMF voltage, and it can be measured in, and it can be used, which is used to convert temperature into voltage. Now some thermocouples we will see. So there are the number of thermocouples shown in the table. So in the first diagram, the one of the our circuit diagram of that thermocouple is shown here, which is made up of iron and constant. That iron and constant means J type of thermocouple is shown in the figure. So how to get the V1 minus V2? So V1 will be the hot junction and V2 will be the cold junction. The difference between two voltages will consider as a conversion of temperature into voltage. Now the output voltage being a temperature difference between two dissimilar junction, that is shown here, that is Vout is equal to V1 minus V2. So hot junction is shown in this figure. So J and K thermocouples are mostly used. So in the table J and K, J type of thermocouple is made up of iron and constant, and the temperature sensitivity will be the 0 degree to 750 degree Celsius, and the diagram is also shown there. So K type will be made up of nickel chromium and nickel aluminium. So its temperature range will be the -200 degree Celsius to 1250 degree Celsius. So such type of thermocouples we are going to use in many industries to control the temperatures of various circuits or various applications. The operating principle of thermocouple is very easy to understand. So when it is fused together, the junction of two dissimilar metals such as copper and constant, so we are here, they are given the description about T-type. So the thermocouple effect, which gives a constant potential difference of only a few millivolts between them, this voltage difference between two junctions is called as Seebeck effect, as a temperature gradient. So the output voltage is nothing, output voltage of a thermocouple is nothing but a function of the temperature changes between two points. So thermocouples can be made from a variety of different materials, which is enabled to measure the temperature between -200 degree Celsius to up to 2000 degree Celsius. So all the type of thermocouples given in the table, its temperature sensitivity range is also given. So it will sense -200 degree Celsius up to +2000 degree Celsius. So it is very useful. Next one will be the type of IC based or semiconductor based IC temperature sensor. There are the number of sensors. So one of the sensor which is mostly commonly used in the number of applications, and it is easily available in the market, and it will be the easier, it will be the very economical one. So that will be the LM35 temperature sensor. So it is a very precision integrated circuit temperature sensor whose output voltage is linearly proportional to the temperature, which is measured in degree Celsius. So the features of LM35 temperature sensors are given here. LM35 sensor has three pins. So first pin will be that will be the input voltage given for this So output voltage is in between 0 millivolt to 10 millivolt per degree Celsius. So that is given here. It will operate from 4 to 30 volts. So ground will be there. So V in, V out, and ground like this, there will be there. So it will be calibrated. There are the some features. So it will be calibrated in the degree Celsius, that is centigrade. It will operate for minus 55 degree Celsius to plus 150 degree Celsius. It will be suitable for remote applications. So the cost of this sensor will be very low. It operates from 4 to 30 volts. Low self heating. These are the some features of LM35 temperature sensors. Now next we will see the signal conditioning circuit. So this will be the very important part we requires for the chapter number or unit number 5 and 6 to control the temperature devices or to control the circuits in which we are going to control the temperature. So first of all, we will discuss about the signal conditioning circuit. What do you mean by signal conditioning circuit? So basically, signal conditioning is a circuit which is used to convert one form of signal into another form. Okay, now there are these are also used for conversion of physical quantities such as temperature, pressure, displacement, etc. into a equivalent electrical signal. Means it is just like acting as a transducer which will converts the physical quantity into a electrical signal. The electrical signal may be in the form of voltage signal or current signal. So signal conditioning circuit is also used to convert one form of signal into another form, that is voltage to current, current to voltage, like this. So all these are called as signal conditioning circuits. So signal conditioners are very useful for conversion of electrical quantity such as voltage or current into equivalent current or voltage, that already we have seen V2I, I2V, V2V. So these devices are used for signal transmission according to the requirement. So we will see the now transducer type of signal conditioning circuit. So transducer bridge is the very important. So transducer bridge I will show, that is shown in this figure. So transducer bridge is very important in the type of it is required in the on-off controller. A resistive transducer whose resistance changes according to change in physical quantity is connected in one of the arm of the bridge. So transistor bridge, the name itself indicates it is in the form of bridge here. So in there will be the four arms. So in one of the arm we are going to connect the RTD like transistors whose resistance will change according to change in temperature, suppose. So it is denoted as the change in resistance will be denoted as RT plus minus delta R. So delta R will be the change in resistance due to the change in temperature or whatever the physical quantity. So mostly we are going to use for change in temperature. So where RT is the resistance of transistor and delta R is the change in resistance according to change in physical quantity. So physical quantity already discussed, that may be temperature, that may be pressure, that may be distance, but mainly we are referring related to RTD, we are referring as a temperature. So if bridge is balanced, then delta R will be zero, that is there will not be any change in resistance. So at that point VA is equal to VB, that is the potential difference between the resistance, that is VA and VB, and this is called as balanced bridge conditioner. So when bridge will be the in balanced condition, at that time we can say delta R will be the zero, that is change in resistance will be zero, then VA becomes equal to VB, that is the difference between will be becomes zero. At this condition we can call it as balanced bridge condition. So here transistor bridge is shown here in the diagram. So four resistors are connected, RA, RB, RC, and in the fourth arm the RTD is connected. That RTD having resistance RT plus minus delta R, the resistance may decrease or increase, it depends on the temperature. So VA minus VA and VB, these are the potential difference or voltage across RA and RB respectively. So VDC will be the excitation, DC excitation given to that transistor bridge. So in balanced condition VA is equal to VB. So VDC, how to find out VA now? If supply voltage is VDC, so apply by using voltage division you can find out VA and VB. So VA is equal to VB. So VA is nothing but VDC into RA divided by RA plus RT. So when balance condition will be there, delta R obviously 0. So that's why only RT is taken. So VB will be VDC into RB divided by RB plus RC. So VDC, VDC will get cancelled. RA divided by RA plus RT is equal to RB divided by RB plus RC. So select the values of resistors. So that will be the equal. So that it will balance the bridge. Therefore, RA is equal to RB is equal to RC is equal to RT is equal to R. So when the bridge will not be a balanced one, when bridge will not be a balanced one, that is, as physical quantity changes, the resistance of transistor also changes, which causes the bridge to unbalance. That is, VA should not be equal to VB. Now, at that time, how to find out the voltage difference between VA and VB, that we will see. Now, when bridge is in unbalanced condition, VA is equal to VDC into RA divided by RA plus RT plus minus delta R. Whereas VB is equal to VDC into RB divided by RB plus RC. These two we are going to calculate by applying now simply a voltage division rule. So VA and VB, once we are getting, now find out the difference. That difference is nothing but VAB. So VAB is equal to VA minus VB. Now put the values of this VA and VB. So take a common VDC. So once you are taking the common VDC, inside bracket, what is remaining? RA divided by RA plus RT plus minus delta R minus RB divided by RB plus RC. So now again, if we are selecting RA equal to RB equal to RC equal to RT equal to R, means all these four resistors, if you are supposing selecting as the same, that is R, then the equation becomes R divided by 2R plus minus delta R minus R divided by 2R. So the final equation will be VAB is equal to VDC into take the LCM plus minus delta R divided by 2 into in bracket 2R plus minus delta R. This will be the equation for finding out the voltage difference, which is nothing or which is directly proportional to change in temperature value. Now next will be the instrumentation amplifier or precision amplifier, you can say instrumentation amplifier. So VA and VB, whatever the output we are getting from the transistor bridge, that we can apply for the amplification, because the signal strength is very, very low. That VA and VB we can connect directly to the instrumentation amplifier for amplifying the signal. The circuit diagram of instrumentation amplifier is shown here. Here three op amps are used here. So R5 will be the potentiometer that will use for controlling the gain here. So we will see what will be the different characteristics are there of an instrumentation amplifier. The first one is, it will be the accurate closed loop gain, obviously. It has high input impedance, obviously op amp has high input impedance, low output impedance, as good amplifier have high input impedance and low output impedance. So it is also having low output impedance. So CMRR, that is common mode rejection ratio, will be the very high. Slew rate will be the very high. Low time and thermal drift, low power consumption, it takes very low power. So output voltage of instrumentation amplifier is given by here. So first of all, we will find the voltage Vx, that is the output voltage of first op amp, and also we can find out the output voltage of second op amp, that is Vy. So Vx is equal to Va in bracket 1 plus R4 divided by R4 plus R5 minus Vb into R4 divided by R4 plus R5. So here we are going to use the superposition theorem to find out Vx and Vy. So when we can say, when Vb is equal to 0, when Vb is equal to 0, at that time what should be the value of Vx, and when Va is equal to 0, at that time we are going to find out what should be the value of Vy. So by adding this, or by using superposition theorem, we are getting these two equations. Vx is equal to Va into 1 plus R4 divided by R4 plus R5, because it acts as a now what? non-inverting amplifier minus VB into R4 divided by R4 plus R5. Next, VY also we are going to calculate. VY is equal to VA into minus R4 divided by R4 plus R5 plus VB into 1 plus R4 divided by R4 plus R5. Now, V0 is nothing but, V0 is nothing but output of the third op amp that simply takes the difference between two voltages, that is a Vx and Vy. So Rf will be the feedback resistor, R1 will be the input resistor. So Vx, V0 is equal to Rf divided by R1 into Vy minus Vx, because Vy is connected at the non-inverting terminal and Vx is connected at the inverting terminal. So it simply take the difference between two voltages applied to that op amp. So V0 is equal to Rf divided by R1 into Vy minus Vx. Now put the value of Vy and Vx in the equation. So V0 is equal to Rf divided by R1 as it is. So in bracket 1 plus 2 R4 divided by R5 bracket complete into Vb minus Va. So as value of Vx and Vy we are putting, so we will get the final equation that V0 is equal to Rf divided by R1 into in bracket 1 plus 2 R4 divided by R5 bracket complete into Vb minus Va. So instrumentation amplifier consists of two stages. The first stage is composed of two op amps A1 and A2, while the second stage is the difference amplifier which is formed by op amp A3. The overall voltage gain is given by, the gain is given by V0 divided by Vb minus Va, that is equal to Rf divided by R1 into 1 plus 2 R4 divided by R5. So this gain can be changed by varying the potentiometer R5. So R5 near set to 0 or infinity. So R5 will give the change in the gain of the amplifier. So R5 will be the very important here, which is used to change the gain of instrumentation amplifier. Okay, now this will be the signal conditioning circuit. These are will be the design of we can say design of signal conditioning circuit requires to control the various devices which are based on the temperature. So in this lecture we studied or we discussed about different temperature sensors, different transducers and signal conditioning circuit and instrumentation amplifier. Thank you.